How does a game engine render complex 3D objects on screen? For my FuniTinker engine, it all starts with a file format called GLTF 2.0. Let me show you how it works. You know how in game development there's endless amount of file formats for anything? Well, for 3D models, I decided to simplify things and use only GLTF 2.0. Why? It was created by the same people that created OpenGL and Vulkan. And since I use OpenGL, it should work really well together. And it does. The main reason why I chose this file format is just how simple it is to understand. It's made up of two parts. One is a simple human readable and quickly parsable JSON file, which contains the layout of the model. And the other one is a binary file that holds all the data. This makes GLTF 2.0 simple to understand, but still really fast to use. I could just use a library to parse the whole GLTF, but where's the fun in that? The main reason why I'm making FuniTinker engine from scratch is because I want to learn how this stuff works under the hood. Now, that doesn't mean I'm against using libraries altogether. If there's a boring, well understood task that a library can handle efficiently, I'm all for it. I don't want to do that. For example, I'm using YYJSON to take care of the JSON parsing. It gets the job done and it lets me focus on the juicy parts of parsing GLTF that I really want to learn. Let's see the GLTF format in action. I'll make a quick cube in Blender and export it as GLTF, choosing the option to split it into two files. Now we have a .gltf and a .bin file. The gltf file is the JSON map and the binary file is the raw data. Let's see. At the top of the gltf file is some basic info like which software was used to create the file. In our case, it's Blender. Then we have a scene hierarchy made up of scenes, nodes and meshes. The important part are the accessors and buffer views. The accessors tell us what kind of data we're looking for and the buffer views tell us where in the binary file we can find it. Speaking of which, the binary file is just raw data. It's just a bunch of numbers and bytes. It would be really hard to find our object there if we didn't have the knowledge of where to look from our GLTF file. Thanks to it, we know exactly how to interpret. Let's take a look into the bin file. Using our GLTF map, we know that the position data should be in buffer view 0 and we should be looking 3D vector made out of floats. And we know that there should be 24 of these vectors. Buffer view 0 is located in buffer 0, its length is 288 and the offset is 0, meaning it's the first 288 bytes of the binary file. And that's it. Now we can take these, put them into a vertex array object and we have these vertices making up our mesh. Now we can render it, but how does the GPU know what the object is supposed to look like on the screen? That's where shaders come in. Shaders are little programs running on the GPU, telling it what to show on screen. The main ones we want to use are vertex shader and fragment shader. The vertex shader takes in the vertices of an object and transforms them, providing positional data for the fragment shader. This is where you can add cool effects to the vertices like waves. The fragment shader is responsible for coloring in the space where the object is on screen. You can use simple colors, textures, anything you need to ensure the object looks right. Let's take a look at a few shader setups and what the result looks like. Here we have a wavy vertex shader with blue fragment shader, which looks like the waves of an ocean. Or we can have a bopping vertex shader that expands and retracts with pinkish fragment shader that looks like an alien. Or we can have a very simple vertex shader, but a fragment shader that takes in the normal data and colors the object based on it. And that's how FuniTinker engine loads in 3D models and renders them using these simple little programs called shaders. Thank you for watching. Subscribe if you want to.